The gentleman from Prince William, Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Speaker, I rise to speak to the resolution.
The gentleman has the floor.
Mr. Speaker, I look around this chamber tonight, and I look full in the face of people, some of whom have spoken, Colonel L. Scott Lingenfelter, United States Army, Colonel L. Mark Dudenheffer, United States Marine Corps. I don't believe he's in the chamber now, but Commander Chris Stolle, Commander Mark Cole. Oh, there you are. Sorry. I think Lieutenant Commander Rick Morris, Captain Jackson Miller, Sergeant Tim Hugo, and many others who have worn the cloth of our country. And I feel compelled to try to bring this discussion back to what I believe is the essence of the question before the body. And that question is the keeping of one's oath, one's solemn vow to one's nation, one's constitution, one's fellow citizenry, who count on America's military to provide for the common defense. Virginia is home, as you've heard many times, to 830,000 veterans and some 250,000 men and women who currently wear the uniform as active duty and as guardsmen and reservists serving our country and our commonwealth. They understand this concept of true faith and allegiance, this concept of obedience to the Constitution, this concept of fidelity to the solemn vow that they took to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. And while I'm talking about oaths, I would like to make one parenthetical statement that has been eating at me for this and the previous two terms or two sessions that I have been here, and that is this. What separates the men and women of our nation who wear the uniform if taken an oath and the men and women who serve in the legislatures and in all the states? And it's this. In this chamber, to sit in these very precious seats that we occupy, we take an oath to support the Constitution. Look at your constitutional oath as prescribed in the Virginia Constitution. It is to support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the Commonwealth of Virginia. But men and women who choose to wear the uniform of our nation vow to preserve, protect, and defend. And that is a different oath. It is an oath where one vows to lay their life on the line for their fellow man. And it's in this regard that this takes on so much meaning for men and women who have worn the uniform of the country. Our concern is that the nominee chose to violate that solemn, sacred oath of office that called a national service and sacrifice the uniform that he wore. And therein lies the challenge. It is about an oath, a keeping of a solid and most sacred vow. Those who choose to speak outside the parameters of that oath need to step outside of their significant military responsibilities, and they are significant because the men and women of this country who wear the uniform hold in their hands, their mortal hands, literally the thunderbolts of the nation. And they need to step outside and make their case from without. To do otherwise erodes the military effectiveness and the mission readiness of the United States military. And therein lies the concern. America's Air Force, Army, Navy, and Marine Corps is the most lethal the world has ever known and has been the protector of peace for 2.5 centuries. And the important thing to remember is the reason it has done that job so capably and effectively is simply because it is manned, the military services are manned by men and women who keep true faith and allegiance to their oath. I would urge this body to reject the nomination.